Welcome to HB RV Lifestyle, the podcast. I am the host, the Honey Badger, here to give it to you straight and transparent about the RV business, as well as other things. And today, I have lots to cover, including breaking news out of Indiana that I believe will affect the entire RV industry, as well as the RV community. And that includes frame failure / frame flex. But first, what I want to start with is some RV financing stuff that has come up over the last 2 weeks. And if you're wondering, yes, in the background, we're back in the Sundance travel trailer, the little used one. We sold the Alliance Valor that I moved into and did a last couple episodes in. Very happy for that family. It was the right unit, the right price. Everything worked out great. They're subscribers to the main channel, so reach out to you guys. Thank you so much for your business, and thank you for trusting me to help you out. They are a part of the reason why I'm starting with RV financing is because there's five customers that things have come up that I guess I don't fill in the blank very well on the main channel. So I want to fill in the blank here, okay? So I want to start with five. We're going to do three out of the five stories because three of the stories in total are very similar, okay? And the first story is I have a customer that walks in the lot, doesn't know who I am, never followed me, 604 FICO score or somewhere in that vicinity. Been on the job for 26 years, same position, same job. Works for a city, county, state type of situation. So government job, steady paycheck, etc. But co-signed for a car with his daughter, who his daughter quietly stopped making payments and repoed the car. Okay. And that was 7-8 months ago. Same kind of context, I have another customer that was injured on the job, was on disability, came back to the job, union guy, but during the 3 months that he was on disability, he was 30 days late 3 times in a row on a car payment. Okay. And the last one was someone who's self-employed with a 1099 form, but hasn't filed taxes in 2 years. So there's three subprime customers that normally I can get loans for if as long as you can prove your income. Well, the understanding from these folks is that they were told or penciled out by another dealership at 9% interest. Okay. 9% over a 7-year, 8-year period. I'm like, great, we can probably do that. I have a lender who does something like that on a 4, 5, or 6-year note. Oh no, but we don't like the payment at that. We want our payment lower. So I showed them all what the payments would be at the worst interest rate that these three subprime lenders I call them the M banks do. And that interest rate is 19.95 over either 12 or 15 years, depending on the amount they're financing. And their head hit the roof. Oh, no, no, no. We can get a better interest rate somewhere else. Okay. So we gave a purchase order. Here, go to your credit union, see what you get. Didn't hear from the people ever again. In fact, what's interesting is I got calls from other dealerships saying, did you tell these people you could get them 10% interest? I'm like, no, you guys know how I am with folks that don't have very good credit. I slap them upside the head and metaphorically and show them what reality is so that way they can go and enjoy themselves, you know? So those three customers are still shopping for an interest rate that does not exist at their current FICO score. So I want to remind everybody that if your credit score is under 740, in this industry, you are considered subprime. you are not considered good credit. Now, as I've talked about a lot in other videos on the main channel, when you're 670 to, let's say, 739, I call that the gray area, where we use credit unions and things like that to get a little bit more in line of what your real interest rate should be. But when you're under 670, you're close to 20% interest. It's just a fact, unfortunately. Okay, sometimes we can get you 15, sometimes we can get you 16. But I want to remind everybody that this industry is different than cars. It's different than mortgages. This is considered a toy. This is like you going and buying an Xbox, or, you know, a boat, or, you know, a motorcycle. They do not consider this a need. And the criteria to finance one is completely different. So the folks that bought the Valor, when we pulled her credit, she was a 763 FICO score. She has amazing credit. Could not get her a loan through a traditional credit union or through a traditional RV bank, where the rate should be somewhere in the 8% range, 8.5% range. Couldn't even come close. I had to send her to a subprime lender. Why? Because credit score is only half the battle. I'll give you an example. I have people come up to me all the time. Well, look at my score. My score says I'm a 780. And I pull them and they're a 701 or 702. And I give them the piece of paper and they want to argue with me. Dealerships and banks do not control the ratings agency and how they view credit. The really screwed up part, and if you have kids, this is the time to remove them out of the room, because there's going to be some cussing. 3, 2, 1. Okay. Fucking banks control loans. The stupid, shitty credit agencies control what our rating is. Now, there's some positives involved in that. The positives are, is the banks have their own internal scorecard system to try to counteract what the ratings agencies say your credit is. But that's also a really fucked up thing, because that's the reason why I couldn't get this lady with outstanding credit. Yeah, her score is an 800, but her actual credit was really outstanding. And I get to get her a 13.5% interest loan. The credit unions turned her down. Banks turned her down. This internal scorecard has a lot of interesting things that I don't understand. It's an algorithm. Yet, I get a guy, watch this. This is the most recent one. Okay. Guy calls in, finishes a credit app with my finance guy. Finance guy pulls the guy. He's a 705 or 706, 708, somewhere around there. Okay. Will had written down, my finance guy, Will, had written down that before he pulled the credit, he had written down a piece of paper that I was talking to him about. Like, the guy says he's a 788 FICO. He's looking for 6.99. He's putting, I think, zero down or $1,000 down or whatever the case may be on like a $33,000, $34,000 toy hauler. And I go, well, that's going to be tough, but if he's a 780, we got a shot at it. The guy comes in way below a 780, but that's, he might show on his phone he's a 780 or an 800 or an 808. Okay. So then what's very interesting is if you look at the guy's credit is absolutely outstanding. Never late with a payment. And at first, because I didn't look that deep into it, because I'm like, well, send it to these banks. I showed them how to structure the deal properly, because the FICO score isn't there, to give us our best shot at the internal scorecard making them a tier one or tier two, maybe a tier three. And if you guys go back to some of my original videos about this, I actually talk about this where there are people that have 710, 715 FICOs I've pulled that pull a tier one with one of the banks and gets the prime rate. And then I get folks that are 820, 830 scores and they're tier five because of that internal scorecard. Okay. It sucks, guys. I'm not saying it's right, but this is the facts, right? That's why I keep saying there's so many things that are involved in RV loans and RV financing. There's so many fucking stupid shit things that, and it's always constantly moving around and changing. The basics are still the same. So you still, your terms and your basics are still the same. The dollar amount financed, your interest rate, the dollar amount financed and your down payment still affect your interest rate. So zero down gets a higher rate than somebody with a 25% down. That's all still true. But now all this internal scorecard bullshit keeps coming up, right? And every bank and almost every credit union I work with uses the same crap or something similar. So anyway, long story short, we did get the guy, I had a call in a favor, but I got the guy a decent approval pending some stipulations. But like U.S. Bank, who he's already had like two loans through, automatically turned him down. Call it in. Nope. His score is way too low. I'm like, what did he score? 688. I'm like, okay, can't argue with that one. Call the other bank that turned him down. His internal scorecard was really low. His FICO was like 740 something with them, but his internal scorecard was really bad. When I called in the favor, and this is what I really want to touch on, because I know it took a while to get to, but this is really important. Because I didn't get that deep into the actual history. I just saw, okay, yeah. Because I'm like, I know where we need to go. Call in the third bank. The third bank, I talked to a senior underwriter. And I'm like, brother, tell me why these guys are turning this dude down. I mean, he's perfect. Lots of time on the job, like 20 plus years on the same job, same company, blah, blah, blah. And he goes, well, John, let me tell you what I see. He says, the gentleman took out two auto loans last year for a combined $1,600 a month. I go, what? And he goes, yeah, and he hasn't even paid a year on them yet. He says, now, he says, I'll do the loan because as long as he comes up with these stipulations we need, we'll do the loan. And it was a shit, dude. I mean, for a guy having the FICO score he has on with a non-auto score, he's getting an amazing rate. I won't tell you what it is, but it's an absolutely outstanding rate considering what his FICO score is when we pulled it. And, brings me back to what I've been saying for the last 15 years. Okay. Now, I don't think it had to do with this guy, but it brings me back to what I've said for 15 years. Buy the RV before you buy the truck. Buy the RV before you buy the house. Buy the RV before you buy the boat. When they look at an RV loan, recent credit history is very, very important. When you take out large loans, it makes the banks pause, makes credit unions pause, makes lenders of any kind pause, no matter what your FICO score is. And here's a better example, because this guy didn't, no, that's not what this guy did, at least not as far as I can tell. But here's the best story. At Beaumont RV, when I was over there a couple of years ago, we had a couple, two guys, I think it was husband and husband, walk into the dealership. Their dream is to hit the road. It's been that way for like 5 years. They decided COVID woke them up and said, you know what, screw it. We're just going to hit the road and do this. Build their business, travel around the country, live in a fifth wheel. I told them three different occasions, look, I know you don't have the truck yet, but do not go buy the truck on credit until the RV loan is set up. They called my partner Doug and told Doug, tell John he's full of crap. the truck guy told me that I need to buy it now. And we need to secure the truck before we even think about the fifth wheel. Doug goes, okay, no problem. So I didn't know about this until they pull in with the truck. And these guys are outstanding. These guys are studs. Every bank, every credit union, every single lender, including the subprime lenders, said no. 800 scores. Bought a $90,000 truck. And even with 50% down, they would not touch these guys. Great, outstanding income. Everything is outstanding. And every underwriter that I tried to call in a favor with said, no. Let them pay on that truck for 2 years and then we'll consider it. So when I get told I'm a liar, when I get told that I'm some kind of jackass, that I'm just a sales guy, I can give you tons of examples where people with the best credit on God's green earth, I can't get them a loan because they don't listen to the advice because I'm a sleazy salesperson. Literally, I've had people tell me that to my face. You're a liar. You're just a sleazy salesperson just trying to make a sale. You're trying to put me in a bad position. Okay. Don't come to me when you find out when you, and I told one guy one time, I said, hey, you come back here with a truck or with a boat or whatever you're going to buy before you get the RV. Just remember, I'm going to tell you, I told you so. I've done that a couple times. All right, let's go into the breaking news. So the breaking news, I'm not going to read the entire article, but I'm going to put the article in the description box of the episode. And it is it says Winnebago QT result. I'm sorry, wrong one. Where's my thingy? Oh, man. What did I do? No. Where is it? I'm sorry. It's my computer's going nutty. Okay. Well, anyway, it is it's an article about Winnebago. And Winnebago, this is different than the other one I had. Here we go. Winnebago faces forecasting challenge amid soft sales. So what they want to talk about, and it was written in the Wall Street Journal as well, but I'll put the RVBusiness.com link in the description, whether you're on Spotify, Amazon, YouTube, etc. You can click on it. The nitty-gritty of this article is that Winnebago is not getting the retail and wholesale sales as a whole. And this includes, from my sources, includes Grand Design RV. Supposedly, and the speculation is Grand Design is going to be massively down in retail sales this year, worse than some of the other manufacturers when it comes to percentage wise. And a lot of it is not because of the actual problem with frame failure, but because of the allegations against Grand Design made by thousands of people, not tens of people or hundreds of people, thousands of people are alleging that Grand Design is treating them like a substandard citizen. Whether they're a first owner, a second, a third owner, they pretty much have wiped their hands clean of the situation and want it to just go away. That's the speculation across the community and across the industry. Now, here's the interesting part. The interesting part is that Winnebago is normally pretty efficient at getting through recessions because their motorhome department builds parts and sells parts. And not just parts to customers who own Winnebagos and dealerships, but they sell parts to other manufacturers of RVs. Because they make a lot of their own stuff. Cabinets, bolts, nuts, brackets, etc. If you went inside a Winnebago motorhome right now, probably close to 70-75% of that motorhome is all stuff built in Forest City, Iowa at their actual manufacturing facility. It isn't all shipped from China or Indiana or wherever and assembled in a factory like Jayco, Keystone, Forest River, etc. Okay. So think about this for a second as we're talking about this. Probably the best built motorhome in the industry. You could argue Newmar, you could argue Tiffin, okay, but arguably the best built motorhome in the industry may fail. Because, and I told them this a long time ago, there was a gentleman named Mike that used to be a rep for Winnebago. And I got with him and a couple other guys I knew at Winnebago. This is 2014, 2015. I said, the worst mistake you guys could ever make is to reopen the trailer division, the towable division, because their towable division has never been run like the motorized. Never. They are run shitty. Winnebago towables, in my professional opinion, are the fucking worst trailers ever built. They're worse than Coleman's that freaking Camping World sells. And that's saying something, because we make jokes calling Coleman half book. Because if the book's 10 grand on Coleman, it's worth less than 5 grand. We all make that joke because they're built like absolute crap. That 17B is junk. Winnebagos are built worse than that, in my professional opinion. Okay. So you have, and that's what's so interesting. It's like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. It's like Two-Face from Batman. Like Harvey Dent is the motorized section, and the other half, which is Two-Face, is the towable division. Two separate like ways of doing business. And I've said this before, Grand Design RV took Winnebago from last place in market share to first place overnight. And the towables and the motorized are run by two different people, two different sets of people. Who does Don Clark really report to? I could tell you it's more than likely not, just my opinion, but it's more than likely not the CEO of Winnebago. It's more than likely somebody in Winnebago Towables first. So can you imagine that? This is like, okay, this is like going to Mitsubishi. Sorry if you love Mitsubishi. This is like going to Mitsubishi and say, hey, Mitsubishi, we're going to have you take over Tesla. I mean, the worst car builder versus one of the luxurious electric cars. Yeah, we're just going to let you go ahead, Mitsubishi, buy him out. Buy out Elon Musk. I mean, what the fuck? I mean, I saw this coming, guys. I didn't see the frame being the problem, but I saw this coming. And I told them a long time ago, this was a stupid, stupid idea to start Winnebago Towables again. Because it's just not run the same. And now there is a chance that people are going to get stuck with their Grand Design rigs, with their alleged frame failure. You can go and call and talk to the federal government, talk to the NTHSA, and you can go report fraud, and you can do all that stuff. And I'm not saying don't. For heaven's sake, I would never tell you not to do that, but I would tell you it will go nowhere. Because from this article, when you read it, you're going to get the sense that Winnebago will not be able to do the recall. And Lippert is going to wash their hands of it. So what they're going to do instead is they're going to probably do the same thing they've been doing, or like say they've been doing. Here are the three biggest allegations of what Grand Design RV is doing. And apparently, it is allegedly and speculated that it is coming from the upper echelon of Winnebago themselves making Grand Design do this. Now, those are allegations. That is speculation. That is not fact. But that being said, from what I am understanding, they're instructed to either fix the rig and people have signed non-disclosure agreements. They are buying out the rigs and then giving down payment to people to go buy another Grand Design product, then having them sign a non-disclosure agreement and removing all their posts. And that's the third one, is have them remove everything that has to do with frame failure and frame flex. And allegedly now, they have hired an additional team to start hunting down the people that are making these allegations and having their social media posts, YouTube videos, Rumble videos, TikToks, all removed. Good luck to them shutting me down. They ever tried that? Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo! You guys can only imagine what I would do if they actually physically tried to do that to my YouTube channel. They did to my TikTok. This is funny. TikTok contacted me again 3 days ago saying somebody called one of my videos I did abuse. I was being abusive. So they took down, first it was bullying, now it's abusive. So I took down, they took down the video and they emailed me and I put in the silly stuff and hit the thing saying I'm going to dispute that it's not abusive. It was one of the podcast episodes where I was talking about, my Facebook posts being removed. Okay. And like within 5 hours, that video was up and running and it went from 600 views to 7,400 views overnight. See, I have a tough time. Now, I know Meta will do whatever it takes to appease every human being on Earth, okay? I've had stuff removed off of Facebook and Instagram. If it has anything, frame failure, frame flex, anywhere that is in a Grand Design group or in a Keystone, not in a Keystone group, because I actually did that with Montana. I'm in groups with the Montanas, Jayco Pinnacles, and actually I don't have them removed off those, but I've had them removed out of Grand Design. And I've had posts that I've made to my own personal page where I have a video about frame flex, frame failure, and Grand Design has had that removed, or someone that allegedly works for Grand Design. So allegedly, they're having these posts removed. And yet people are still like drinking the Kool-Aid, right? But then again, they're not, because Winnebago's losing their ass. So I'm wondering, is there a silent protest out there? Is there a silent little war against Winnebago and Grand Design where kind of what happened with Bud Light and Target? Is that going on? Have I not caught up to the times yet? Possible, right? And interesting. So, sorry. I just thought about that. That would be bitchin' if that was real, if that was true. But then again, it's like, I got an email yesterday. Great email. It was talking shit about me, but it was a good email because, I took out of it a lot of things that I understand from the viewer's perspective. It challenged me that I should not talk about integrity since I don't sell or own a Grand Design product. But see, I understood it. So, but one of the things I want to say about the word integrity has to do with there are now six people. I have blocked their phone number. I have blocked their social media. I don't want to talk to them anymore. Why? Because they no longer have integrity in my eyes. I've already talked about the cabinet people, but I want you to look at this. It doesn't matter what the situation was. It doesn't matter if your wife was in the fifth wheel and was tipping over. It doesn't matter if you went and bought it because of cabinets. It doesn't matter if, oh, well, they promised everything would be fine and the moon and the stars. It doesn't matter. They now have you by the cojones. They now have you by the balls. If you took their money, not the buyout, if you took the speculative money, the allegations of you being given a check for a down payment on your next Grand Design product, or maybe they gave you the full amount of money that you paid for your rig. Whatever that may be, you now had to sign a non-disclosure agreement. You now had to remove your videos. One guy had to remove all of his videos about frame failure and frame flex. One family was ordered to remove all of their social media that they were making money on because they're full-timers and were. And then the other couple that I know of had to remove every single thing, including a group that they had on, I think it was Instagram or Snapchat, I can't remember. They had kind of a, not a group, but I think they call it a channel or a broadcast channel or something of that nature. It's a little different than Facebook. And they had to remove that. So let me tell you why you not only screwed up your integrity with me, but you screwed up in general. Forget that you gave them more money and gave them clout or gave them less headaches. If it happens again, and obviously they have not come out and said anything about this publicly. If it happens again, they have you by the balls. Because now that you signed a non-disclosure agreement, you cannot go out and talk about it anymore. Give you an example. Reflection. Let's say a reflection that was sold for the last quote unquote 10 years and 10,000 of them were built. And that thing ends up with frame failure or frame flex and ends up with a major problem. What do you think's going to happen? Let's say you go and do everything you can humanly do with suspension and air ride and all this crap that you can put on these things on a momentum, and your outrigger snap or your frame just completely fails on you. And it's a 2024. What are you going to do? They now have you by the balls. So think about that for a second. I'm not telling you don't go get bought out. If you're getting offered a buyout, take it. Do what's best for your family. But don't go buy another one of their products. There's so many other rigs out there that are just fine. You cannot tell me and look me in my eyes and tell me that there aren't other fifth wheels out there. You can't tell me you went through 200 rigs or 250 rigs or 500 rigs or 1,000 rigs and this is the only one. It just happens to be a Grand Design product because they make the best cabinets or they made 11,000 of this shit. I don't give a fuck. You now have them buy you. They now have you buy your cojones. Period. End of report. And now you gave them more excuses to not publicly acknowledge this. You are a problem now. You are just as bad as they are. You now are the problem. And you know what the worst part is for you guys who went, the six of you that I know of, that went completely against what you had told me? You know what the other people are going to have a problem? Other Grand Design owners when you go to the rallies. If I were the six of you, I would never go, I would hide from a Grand Design rally, hide from other Grand Design owners that are going through frame failure and frame flex, that can't get anything done, that are allegedly having all these problems with the fucking company, because you're going to look them in the eye and you're going to say that you have all the integrity in the world because of cabinets? Just remember that. Until next time, have a good one.